We would like to present Stone Soup Poets live at TT the Bears, featuring Lee Latif, S.A.S.P, Brother Blue, T. Mendenhall, Chief Autumn Tree, Jim Carter, False Prophet, Joanna Neelon, Lisa DiTobo, Bobby Land, Matt Boston, C.C. Ashagra, Jason Stonehill, Tom Zaikow, Mitch and Larry Lewis, Jessie, and Elizabeth Thomas. And of course, as you may know, Stone Soup Poets is performed every Monday night at 8 p.m. at TT the Bears, and Noise Party is broadcast every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. on Channel 55.
In our 25th year of producing poetry and our 11th year of producing a TV show, which tonight is being shot by John Bergstrom, who held that post for quite a while, and we're happy to have him with us tonight. And we have Terry Faison doing lights and sound. We have Nancy Mendick covering the door. And as always, we like to say thanks to our hosts here, Miles and Bonnie Bullettis. Let's have a hand for everyone. I'd like to, at this time, welcome to the stage the epigallotic Lee Latif with guest.
This is dedicated to my book, Games You Can Play in Bed. The obstreperous erotic mattress. Masculine gluteus maximus lean and feminine Cossack grind. That rump roast bump, chicken fat hump, shit spatter jam jelly reflex, chocolate syrup, wiggle sacral tushes with buttressing, quaking horniness.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Ooh. Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Foe, salivate, unfetter lavender lingua, the spermaceti blindfold, slobbering knee-high, Cajun frenzy crook, gout sickle cell, effeminate Republicans, tibialis anteria, during your irreligious septum, mess of a foul play, Colonel Sanders finger-licking fried bisectic leg. Vacuum urinal uterus launder a chromosome maternal section of that hairy seductive cucumber, undressing coffee or hot dog, saltgrass pudenda salami, pajama wedding, banana peeling, chauvinist, unshaven bush, inducing his infertile brain case not to have any more horse fucking sex. Turn the demented page. Polygynous aphrodisiac dissolute and ungracious slosh incest. Those warm gravy debacles. Susie cream cheese lumbago blotch. Musical condom. Turbine pistol. Rheumatism mayonnaise external combustive. Male pig. Female sow. Orgasmatrons. While 13 cocoon balloons firecracker erupt into many neoplasm spumoni malted deluges. Out drink in sordid manhood that guacamole, amygdala, spinach embryo, clam chowder artery, chop suey ischium, hub capping, grease gunning, woman's hood, cuckoo's nest, cunt, in skylark, piston pumping, sex heavens. Thank you very much. Good night.
S.A.S.P. in the house. It's S.A.S.P. on the floor, baby.
Get on the stage.
Like a number from 1 to 200.
199.
3 and 199. 87.
I told Chris.
All right. Quality. How is it that if someone writes some verse and others perceive it to be good, they fancy themselves a poet? I write some verse, and others perceive it to be good, but I don't fancy myself a poet.
Oh, no.
I fancy myself. Quantity. How many times do you sit down to write on Five Hills Brothers Tall Boys? How many times have you sat down to write on Five Hills Brothers Tall Boys and Four Black Beauties? Can you sit down to write on Five Hills Brothers Tall Boys, Four Black Beauties, Three Maxillary Tabs? On Five Hills Brothers Tall Boys, Four Black Beauties, Three Maxillary Tabs, and Two Big Fat Sploogies, then write to fill up space? And now 199. Sneaky Pete glimpses behind curtain cowering schoolboy playhouse park. Needing to be with singular being alone, kneeling to within. Can you keep it down? Star constellation pointing, heavenward vigor. Visions in basement, stark realization that homosexual. I don't believe it either. Feel eyes feeding, tender spring, chicken strutting. You are who you are, dynamic dimension dance. Let go who you aren't. Let's see who aren't I. Many sub-characters be my reality. Let's see who aren't I today. David Allen Boucher, I. I did have a 67, but then I wouldn't be the short attention span poet, I'd be the long attention span poet. But this is good. This is good. But I'm not gonna do it. Thank you.
Short attention span poet. Next shall be someone you don't see enough of. Let's have a great hand for Brother Blue.
Yeah! Coming down here, I heard a guy in the subway playing cello. He's playing some Bach. It was so beautiful. And I saw a guy on the subway, he had a bouquet of violets. I said, there's a poise. So I'm going to do a little thing, and it's an improvisation, and it's for the poets of the world. It's a mad dream. I had a dream this morning. I heard music. It was a time, what time? In a time when the world was young. When the world was old, there was crying everywhere. People were at war. Babies were dying of hunger so early. In that sad, sad time, a poet got up in the night, began to weep. At the suffering in the world, for the broken-hearted, for the broken world. He began to speak his mad song to the stars. Sparks rose up in the night like burning butterflies. They went past the stars. The poet walked barefoot around the world. He walked across the sea on top of the water. He climbed the high mountains, he went through those seven forests. Walked over the burning sands into the middle of the desert. He began to call the poets of the world. And his poem went around the world. All around the world, the poets got up in the night and they began to sing and dance and speak poetry. In many languages, the words were like colored birds rising into the night sky. They came from everywhere. Some were ragged, some were lame, some were barefoot, some were naked. They met in the middle of the desert and they began to speak poetry. Upward to the stars. The angels heard them. Music fell on the earth. All around the earth, the music fell into the ears of the people, waking and sleeping. To the ears of children, to the old men, the old women, and lovers too. And they all began to speak poetry that night. The poems rose like beautiful birds in the night. All night long they did their mad, beautiful thing. And early in the morning, there was a bright rainbow over the sky. The lion kissed the lamb. Stars kiss the sea. The tree bowed down and kissed the ground. People threw their weapons away. The brokenhearted were healed. This broken world became a paradise. This world became heaven. I believe that we, don't you? Oh, poets, it's what we do. Who's gonna sing that song to fix this broken world, to heal the wounded, the dying, the crying? If not me and you, who? Calling all mad fools who will sing the song to heal the brokenhearted, the sad, and turn this mad world into heaven.
Yeah! Blue. No one's gonna have to go to church for another month. Thank you for the seasonal uplift. We needed that.
You got it.
Amen.
Oh, yeah.
I believe it's Lee Mendenhall.
Got it. First poem here is a bit of a dialogue. It's bonsai, which is that art of taking a tree that might grow 60 or 70 feet out in the world and training it down so it can grow on a little one-foot dish. Bonsai. The most important thing in bonsai is to be brutal but careful. Carefully he strips the tender leaves from every twisted branch. I found this specimen downtown almost 20 years ago in a redevelopment lot, half crushed under demolition rubble. He tightens the heavy copper wire, bowing the stunted bough downward, and then nips off the last leaves from the bushy end. Opposite, a shorter branch spirals upward like an arm in a half Nelson. He smooths the gravel around the trunk. You wouldn't want to go there now. There's nothing left alive worth saving. He sets the pots among the other plants, all of them as small. You couldn't find a better example from above the tree line on Mount Fuji, he chuckles. City air stunts him just as good. The front door opened. His son comes in, says, "Hi, Dad." He checks his watch. "Where the hell have you been? I must have told you a million times to get your butt home before 8, and I bet you didn't finish your homework either." The boy runs upstairs, a door slams. He speaks again without a trace of anger. It's important every spring to take off at least the first 2 sets of buds. This is an object poem, ode to burgers. Vegetarians better block their ears. She brought me a world filled at the equator of a fresh Portuguese roll, the thin crust slightly stiffened by a touch of light and even brown, like a sunburned toasted goddess bun dusted with flour, surrounding a fresh and airy sponginess, holding millenniums of baking history, the twin genius of ground wheat and carefully husbanded yeast, combined and kneaded into wholeness, and carefully baked to this perfection. I bite with joy into the soft, bisected bread and find a sliced tomato, seeds and flesh bathed in red and tangy fluid, and placed above, oh, fortunate bonus, smooth melted cheddar, an adult frosting with a nostril quivering, musty, mature acridity, shaped with gentle heat and gravity like fresh snowfall, adhering and invading the fissures of the patty's fire-flavored crust, which still contains, generic though it may be, ground and civilized, the satisfaction of all my carnivorous desires, yielding to my teeth as antelopes to lions. Drenched in hot victorious juices, my tongue celebrates, enacting every flavor bud in torsions of satiety, every bright bite a pair of thanks to one anonymous steer, handsome with individual yet democratic dignity. I crunch the layered lettuce, crisp and youthful green, freshly moistened to the frilly edges, resting finely upon the southern hemisphere indented by my thumbs, which has been anointed with liquids from above. I close on the finish. My tongue patrols my lips and gathers every morsel, the errant streaks on chin. My nostrils graze the flower and fragrances, and my blood sings hymns of rejoicing. My hands remember the heat retained from glowing charcoal. My belly knows her feet. This is a very short, 3-part poem. An only child. Her father left, let me label the parts here. One, her father left when she was young, the cad. She feels abandoned and abused and mad. Two, her mother, distant, weak and cold, a mouse, who hated home but never left the house. Three, now she's a militant, and furthermore, she curses everything her mother bore.
Lee Mendenhall, thank you very much. Next shall be Chief Autumn Tree.
Where's the beef? It's not in the stew. He was a crude dude, lying bag of crap, had a nasty disposition, and he treated folks rude. Still, I thought he would change, until the night came when I sat down to a bowl of potatoes and gravy. With sweetness in my voice, I asked, "What the hell is this?" Clearing the wax from my ears, not wanting to miss a word, His excuse was going to be good. He told a tale of how the company that made the stew forgot to put the meat inside the can, and that I should write and tell them so. And maybe, just maybe, they'd send us a case or two. Crying tears of laughter, almost on the floor, I did not question the fact he had eaten before. Thanksgiving. American bird, already basted. College cranberries cry. Drumsticks, dressing, eating frenzy, gorging gravy, hungry horrors, gobble, gobble, indigestion. Junket kettle, leaving mincemeat, no nuts on pumpkin pie. Question raisin stuffing, pilgrims squash tradition. When turkeys unbutton their trousers, Tom utters ugly, vulgar vultures, worthless wings, exploiting their extremities. Year after year, yams and Yorkshire pudding. Ah, the things I would do just for one's why back. Thank you.
Chief on a tree, thank you. We shall now have Jim Carter.
This is entitled Maidservant's Thoughts. Your light touch as you float across the floor, your swiftness as you waft through the door, a special gift you have by far. My emotions are strong no matter where you are. It seems as though you are everywhere to give me another cross to bear. Should I choose to ignore your existence, you will grow larger with great persistence. It's stubbornness that pours from your soul. It shakes and breaks me until I lose control. Should I let you be, or should I exterminate your existence from this life tree? Your freedom extrudes my jealousy. It must be my immortal fantasy. You know no death, only life, which exasperates my eternal strife.
Jim Carter. Coming to stage now, False Prophet.
These three poems are related, and they're related to taking public transportation and why we're going to drive. When we're going to drop the atomic bomb, and some of the reasons why. You're the one who is sincere. You tell me every snowflake is different like a man's fingerprint, and I have made money shoveling snow like some fucking fairy tale. To me, you tell me this, and I will have to shovel this snow of yours, and there's every snowflake individual like a fingerprint. It is the way of the universe or something, or that you tell me this. Snow is a what? I get to go to the gas station even though I smoke, because I was a fire marshal in college and I once went out with a fireman's daughter. So I know all about hazard till I'm sick in the head. I get to go to the filling station and buy soda and talk to the guy. And you drive up in a car with somebody with dyed blonde hair and cheap sunglasses and her boyfriend. What the world does that word mean? Tell them, try one of mine. He doesn't believe my fingerprint, my ass. This is science fiction. I know how to sail, I know how to keep bells, and I'm a person who's hit Seattle, Boston, New York, and Milwaukee. You told me you went to the beach, but it was raining? Sincerely yours. You wrote a hell of a thing with good intentions. I'll explain for once. You're good at jukeboxes, and you're good at pool, and you're just like everybody else, and you don't matter to anybody at all. You've been neutralized. Your need for suspenders doesn't matter. You're falling away from Grace, wherever she is. Get some mind working overtime. You are not James Dean. You are not a rebel without a cause. Even though there are two different things, you are not a Buddhist. You are just you. Are everything you are. Everything is also plain to see. You are not Uncle Sherman, and this is not your end in the Wayback Machine. You are not Einstein. You are a local man with a quiet plan. You don't mind losing everything going your way. You're supposed to be about non-persons, you are a winner. Like musicals, you're partial to culture, you're an Illinoisian. Without your knowledge, your mom and dad don't care. If you are of age, you should know better. No one can tell you what to do. Place like home, you want to get away, you gamble, you drink, you think everybody likes it, and you have been around for a long time. Everybody knows you know, but they don't know who is everybody. I want your definition. I could care less. You think you can make time with this one you love, the high card, 808, ace of spades, that's your ace in the hole. You're so fucking crazy, I can't believe it. Yeah. Yeah. Happy at ground point zero. They talk about the insides of us as if we were a mere confection or a huge wall of plastic concealed in the very thickets, a maze of zany junk. Well to all, the streamers and screamers of electric blue and red, old and new, the early warning systems, the secret engines in disguise, warped by a Lulu or a lullaby. We are always 5 minutes from subtracting the ether and the thunder from the new surprise in the skies. Far and deep, further away, lamplight. The nose cones aimed at turrets and towers, safer departments of energy. And the name of that contingency is letters and numbers making haste towards mutation. Many eyes and deep gray clusters of zeros populating the dominant shriek from the last doorway. No need to march, no need to worry. There's a cluster of rockets and rocket ships which seek to make a clean and clear break from illusion. You're under the synthetic properties of worldwide delusion that there is peace in the land and goodwill towards men in a captaincy which is able. No longer reports of schemes by the stairs, the vaulting ramps that lead toward the viaducts. Every note and scribble recorded under the hum of a high camera. And the energy is in voltage, bombs destined to knock us out in huge craters while at war and screaming pain with the grayness of psychedelic eyes and the far reach of the cement buttresses over the gray of the seas, the likeness recorded from blink to other blink. Angles, angels, the one to subsist on, the one to hope for, when we all wind up by sauce, by surprise. And they tell us there are more reasons than one. Spies in the supermarkets of suburban America, without equal, watching the proliferation of lesser sites, in deadlock with the familiar bombast shot forth in zigzag waves under the shutter of local knaves. Hanging out in a signal which sends a direct shock and a powerful lave wave. As witness, as bait to the skies. Inside the mother to us is the anguish of a birth and revision, leaving the stomach already having the taste of wisps of smoke, cancer, and cyanide. Weeping and disconsolate is a birth. I've heard more than one birth in the dynamic powwow that threw a world and the whole earth off kilter, to the reaches, to the depths, toward the interlocks of foam breath, without cues, pointers, or tips. There is a riddle without answers. Another radar A-OK, another slap on the ass and a cry, another easy eye, another hero of another comic book. Why stand for the stars and the rockets of illusions many times doomed over and to the coeval lights of daybreak while subatomic silos gather themselves and purr for lesser and lesser ends? The cat is half asleep curled in a ball of orange that engraves the iron ramp in the disguise of the gray skies, the milk. I bother to buy it day old, telltale cap around it, consequence drops splattering on the yellow faded grate of old linoleum while the children play across the man-made gorge of junk in the zany thickets from radiation testites. We bled for atomic milk.
Well, this is profit. Thank you. By the way, we do try and keep to 4 minutes. Just remember that. Okay. Next shall be Joanna Neelon. Oh.
Joanna!
November is the month of the dead. Feels like it, doesn't it? But anyway, we've all lost precious beings. And ultimately, every being is precious. And here's a short poem for my precious younger brother. You flew through the dark tunnel, straight into infinite light, waking from dreams of space, leaving us here in world shadow, still clutching our fear of night, and missing your dear, irreplaceable face. This is a poem about the still living. My mother, my dear mama, whose birthday is going to be this Saturday, November 23rd, a Sagittarian. She and Mary Martin are both Sagittarians, and she even looks a little like Mary Martin. And we're having a grand party for her 90th birthday. 90. And so I have to do a poem that night, and I thought this would be a good chance to practice it. My mother was a flapper. Albertine, Girard, Claremont, Neelon. They wanted an Albert, but they got Albertine, the first of the five when the years were still lean. This scared skinny kid with a prominent smile jumped out a window, Sagittarian style. But somehow she landed straight up on her feet and has landed that way through every defeat. That she lived in a tent, she never lived down. A poor Cinderella without a new gown. What with rickets and nits and undersized tits and no decent clothes to be seen at the Ritz. It's a wonder she turned out to have so much spark.
Thank you.
A flask at the hip and a kiss in the dark. But alas, she became so damned appealing that she caught the eye of William J. Neelon. She dreamed of a palace, she dreamed of a prince, but she got a houseboat and a house dress of chintz. There were compensations, as you can all see. Five splendid offspring, just as brilliant as me. And then followed suit, as soon as was seemly, the grandkids who call her Grammy or Mimi. But there must be much more, a further reward, a feast at least, an Academy Award. After all, she resembles the Mary Martin, although next to Mary, Mimi's a Spartan.
Thank you, Joanna. We have a copy of Two Left of Joanna's book we published several years ago. At the break, we should take a peek at it. Next, we'll have a recent feature, last week's feature. Let's welcome back again, Lisa DiTullio.
Body sits unselfconsciously in her underwear on his lap, content with his strong arms, warm breath on her back and kind words in her ears on this early July morning. If she feels her place is threatened, she answers with a quick tongue and fierce eyes protecting her steak, her boyfriend. Next to them, a woman looks on in amusement. The man steals conspiratory glances her way. She holds his eyes for a moment, then looks away, not wanting to be caught by unsuspecting friends. The night before she met his soul and body, in the blue darkness they laughed, marveled at one another, and poured their words and ideas hot into their essence, where feelings too large for human space somehow ricocheted within, pulling them through the night unconscious of time, till light enveloped and chirping began. She feels an ache now while watching him with his girlfriend. The little girl is fulfilled when in his arms and under his charms. She gives him the secure title, boyfriend. Labels cannot entice the woman. Her security comes from herself. Strong arms will surround her when she builds her own muscle. Yeah, the girl, she has her security. At least till he decides he must go, his arms leave her little body, and with him gone, she feels empty. So she cries. It is all that is still within her power. He tries to console her with a hug. Her mother says, there'll be others, others to break your heart too. When she realizes her crying isn't helping, it subsides a little. Dry-eyed, the woman walks him out, unconcerned with those watching her steps. They may expect to hear of a new relationship. The woman knows they do not understand. The little girl trails after them, tears wiped yet still wearing the look of the newly crushed. The woman is linked to the impulsiveness of the little girl. She cannot just leave this man alone. The girl has her parents, her age, and her bedtime to hold her back. The woman does not, so she asks him for his address there. It was not just a one-night stand, society's explanation. We'll keep in touch, share our minds, if no longer our bodies. John Smith, Nobodyville, USA. He smiles at his half joke. After last night, he is not an anonymous man, no matter what means of denial he chooses. The little girl receives another hug, this time valiantly, without a river of tears. He asks the woman for the same. She says, it was nice meeting you. He laughs at the absurdity of the remark, and they part. He walking down to his car, the woman walking head held high, hand in hand with the little girl, away from the man who in one day so deeply affected them both. They join the party where the girl finds someone else's arms to take comfort in, and the woman sits alone looking on at her friends, trying to re-enter their world, trying to relate. The woman, like the girl, knows she may never see him again, and as the girl hopes for just one more hug to last eternity, so the woman also asks for a link to the reality they left 19 hours before, his address. If she uses it, will she be betraying herself? Or will she be if she doesn't? She could wait it out, stay strong. He would move away, and his smile and words would never again reach her ears. She knows they will come from a more important place. They will rise behind her eyes, behind her ears, where she can enjoy them with clarity. She says to him, did you know I have the stamina of 10 lions? And she is the master, the king, the queen, no longer the princess in a fairy tale, but the ruler within her world. The birds, they are singing to themselves. We are the privileged who hear their song. By Rainer Maria Rilke, a German poet. I really love him. It's called Exposed on the Cliffs of the Heart. Exposed on the cliffs of the heart, look how tiny down there. Look, the last village of words and higher, but how tiny, still one last farmhouse of feeling. Can't you see it? Exposed on the cliffs of the heart, stone ground under your hands. Even here, though, something can bloom. On a silent cliff edge, an unknowing plant blooms, singing into the air. But the one who knows, he began to know, and is quiet now, exposed in the cliffs of the heart, while, with their full awareness, many sure-footed mountain animals pass or linger, and the great sheltered birds fly, slowly circling around the peak's pure denial. But without a shelter, here on the cliffs of the heart.
Oh.
Lisa DiTullio. It's been too long since we've heard our next reader, and it's been a long time in a lot of ways. It's great to welcome back Bobby Blue Land.
Thank you. This first one's called Into Next Week. I was beating him senseless, and then I rescinded. Guilt or compassion? No, I was winded. For a second, I forgot and thought that my grandmother was still alive, just for a nanosecond. This is called The Wisdom of Dad. Dad was in prison for all of my childhood. I had to learn to deal with that. He spent 18 years in hell, mostly in a solitary cell. Parole got him a job in a photo mat. But Dad has wisdom, this is true, some of which I'll share with you. He'd say, kids, you can't have it both ways, so don't even try. I'm not so sure about this because both my brothers are bi. You won't make it on your looks, even with that smile, he told my sister, Cindy Crawford from the House of Style. Careful, or you'll end up a sexual addict, like your mom, I'm afraid to say. She's still an NFL groupie, but she's cut down to 3 bats a day. If the dealer has dandruff, don't buy his cocaine. And don't go shooting your mouth off like Kurt Cobain. So if you're at the photo mat, don't just drive through, because Dad has wisdom. This is true. I've quit drinking. Well, almost. I guess you could say I'm a glass half empty kind of guy. This is called Patty. Her name is Linda, but I call her Patty. P-A-D-I. Because each time I go down on her, I get recertified to scuba dive.
What?
This last one's called Mr. Right. He tells her, with better makeup and a little more self-esteem, you could be a whore. Thank you. I'm Bobby Lynn. Thank you.
That was Bobby Land. A little shift of gears here. We're going to have Max Boston.
The first one is a winter poem. Breakout. Icicles cut up my room. Damn cold clusters cry slowly with despair. And a little sun is sneaking in through the sodden window panes. Hardly can open doors with stumbled strength, blocked by rituals and memories. Slush, crease, mud outside, there movement is impossible. The beaches just below the pavement smell of tropic, flower skies, distance, and sound the beam of seashells. I want to bathe myself in ocean shores, race you in the waves, and cocktail our fun to warm enough. Oblivion, live between the seashells. There's sand in my shoes, icicles clutter up my room, damp cold clusters cry slowly with despair, and the sun smashes through my sodden window panes. Hardly can open doors. How real is real when rationality creeps up from unawares? We don't really mind our clanging chains, but huddle them securely. The following is about sort of this women I've been trying to date recently. It's a bit sad on both sides. Damaged goods. Their hearts are like Ming vases, cracked. In youth they showed their flowers proudly, gave nourishment to everybody's dreams. They were adored, their shiny surface touched, the water level glistened, mirrors made of incense. They were so delicate, so many patterns matched. They had too much trust in roses, too many careless owners handled them like soccer balls, good for presentation, for scoring goals. They were kicked around, emotions splintered, hopes were smashed. Now they cannot harbor flowers, the thoughtless joy blossoms into life. They cannot keep in water, seeping through their memories. And their fluid skin is swirling in the slightest breeze, shards cutting every hand too close. No prince will touch this mess with iron gloves. No super glue will fix these broken vases. And, worst of all, the guarantee has expired. The last one is about communicating too much. The wise, they never speak. I used to be a fool with a mirror that showed you what I see. Like a microscope that showed you, all of you, not much of me. I counted every of your wrinkles, each hair gone gray, pointed to your baggy eyes, dissected all your inner tears. Over the years, I've learned to hide that mirror in deep caverns of my mind and cut my tongue with lies. No longer will I blind you, magnify or burn you with the struggle of my thoughts. The wise, they never speak.
Thank you, Matt Boston. Next shall be C.C. Ashagra.
Hello, people. How are you today?
Very well.
I believe I'm about a week away from getting my books out again. There's going to be two of them, I think. One's going to be called Poems, and the other is going to be called Emotional Geography. And I have a feature coming up at the day before Thanksgiving, third rail downstairs, and maybe I'll have it ready for that, maybe not. Tonight I'm going to read a piece that I wrote, started writing back in 95 after doing a prison poetry reading, and it's a very long piece, and I just spent a lot of time this last week rewriting it, and now it's 15 poems. So I'm going to read three or four of them and mix it up a little bit for you tonight. This is number four. Imagine a single speck of confetti in a kaleidoscopic microcosm, held up to the light, giving insight to society fears itself. Giving insight to social fears themselves. The apparent eye cites laws, justice systems, and police. The apparent eyesight being equal to all born fear looking at you. You remember that every adult does time as a child. The degrees of innocence matters. How it matters at this stage is not used without innocence shedding itself to be new again and to never last. How this stage is raised and how it rises might be about how hard the time is being there and the degrees of innocence matters. How it matters at this stage. How it still matters. Now mind your freedom to the borders of flesh breathing. Yeah. Number one. When raw injustice is the circumstance you're living, is the environment you're living in, regardless of if you were born into it or if you walked into it, if you migrated into it, if you ran into it, if you fell into it, or if you climbed up to its fight, or standing to walk for freedom's peace about it. Who might your living hands be? Who might your living hands be? Number 11. Never do harm to ever balance your fists. Remembering hands are behavior. Remembering your tongue's choices are spirit's voicing, and with silent saving mirrors within you, read your own witnessing reflection. Number 15, this line's from. Truthfully examine. Who owns the right to write out truth in history? Now mind your freedom to the borders of your own flesh breathing, remembering how it feels to breathe free. Bang! Bang! A weapon discharges. A projectile cuts the sky. Nothing lies bleeding. All the world's air cries, and all the children of the world gasp together on what may be their last breath.
Ashagra. I'd like to invite up now Jason Stoneking.
This is called Poetry Slam with a question mark. I got the poems, baby. They're not real poems. I got poems about spacemen, coffee shops, that young cliche that turns tricks up on top of the Herald, Washington Library. I got poems on gun control, on gangbanging, on fisting a man for coke money on South Miami Beach. I got raped poems, I got away poems, they didn't bust me when I was holding poems. I got dreams of opium poems. I got dirty AIDS, needle swapping, death of a junkie poet poems. I got up and wrote one down when we found it on my futon with Coltrane and all that LSD, but you burned that one, so I wrote it back to life poems. I got my poems, I got you poems, I got French existential dementia, let's all wham till the end of time poems. Poems about famine, poems about hieroglyphs, poems without purpose, ones that rhyme, ones that make you retch, ones that make you scratch your head lice metaphor, poems about people that barely exist beyond poems. I sometimes read poems, not for the sake of poetry poems, but to fill us all up narcissistic poems. Need to be heard poems, need to be loved poems, need to get off poems, need to quit writing poems, need to get a real job poems, that could actually change things poems, about giving up all the things that are dying poems, crying poems, if I could just write the one that hasn't been written yet poems. Fuck this poem, fuck you poems, I know you like it when I make you do it poems, blame it all on me poems, escape from your problems poems, I told your mother I'd be writing all about it poems, or your dominant father made you do it poems. You better wipe that idea off your page and don't tell a soul poems, because I saw it all poems, I know it all poems, I got the poems, baby. Everyone, plagiarized, memorized, baptized, circumcised, close your eyes, baby, it only takes 10 minutes to write one. Trust me, who's next?
Stone King. Thank you very much for that. Our last reader in this first open will be Tom Zaikow. Tom.
This poem was inspired by someone that I know very well, who is I think this is a subject that has been spoken about before. Old age. No, it is not the degeneration of cells or the decrepitude of skeletal structure that is mislabeled aging. It is not the sagging of skin, nor the thinning of hair, loss of teeth, that are signatures of old age. Degenerative diseases have hastened infants' deaths and deteriorated the bones of otherwise healthy children, all being labeled tragic circumstances. The hairs of youth have lost color, even fallen, quote, before their time. Teeth, too, have been victims in schoolboy skirmishes, yet none call this old age. Old age? The bartering of aspirations and dreams for the acquired realities of experience, the real crippling discoveries of existence. Yes, this is the real old age, the surrender of belief in man's altruism, the exchange of giving for the acceptance of apathy. It is a time in life, any time, when a final abuse of love or the refusal to acknowledge its power erodes the naive breath of youth. This is the old age that makes the glow, that takes the glow from the youthful skin, or color from its vibrant hair, of the sparkle from the eyes of the soul, or the belief that love is eternal. Knowledge is a dangerous thing, that which replaces naivety. Like a cancer of the marrow, it robs its victim of the very substance of which youth is made, and abandons it to crumble, sapped of the spirit and dreams referred to as youth. There's another well-known subject called absence. Sadness is not making music with the one with whom it most means something. Sadness is coming home from a long trip to find only a dark, empty house once filled with music, laughter, fun. Sadness is not seeing the eyes of that special person after leaving customs, or hearing the voice, or feeling the embrace. It is crying, not knowing why, but knowing. It is remembering fulfilling experiences with one who now desperately tries to avoid them, feeling substanceless after what was given is now pulled back. It is walking alone on a beach where stars, under stars, that see where once 4 feet had strolled. It is looking at the full moon, witness to a lifelong toast, as though it had never existed. Sadness is the pain one feels in one's heart, still beating, with love rebuffed. Sadness is knowing what love is in the face of what it is not. Sadness is loving you. This one, well, you'll see. Yeah, I call it forever. The Sphinx lost its nose, the pyramid its cap. The tombs lost their kings and treasures as well. Anthony lost his Cleopatra, history its Napoleon, and Louis and Churchill, as well as England, its empire. Nothing is forever, they say. Could be. Death and destruction all around, civilizations, governments, Byzantine and Constantinople, even Atlantis, nothing is forever. And yet, the birds return each year to their nests. Leaves return to abandoned branches, and flowers spring anew from dormant bulbs, as the sun, moon, and stars return each day to the firmament. Hope springs eternal from the human breast, they also say, even after youth has lost its naivete. And in the memory of human emotions resides one love which waits for its own springtime of rebirth.
With Tom Zaikow, we take a short break. I want to thank all our open readers, let's have a hand for them. We're back with the wrong heroine, Mitch and Larry Lewis, very shortly.
The wrong heroine?
Next, features Mitch and Larry Lewis.
Friend who's in the audience got us tickets in Great Woods to see Dwight Yoakam, and I guess since then, I'd say for Mitch and me, he's kind of the household musician. Take it away.
All right.
Yeah. dedicated to all men who love too much.
Okay.
Hey, I think you'll... This is an homage to all of you will know, you know what. Mitch and I agreed in the program that age comes before beauty, so carry it away with yours, Mitch.
Okay. This one is a song I just played, you know, kind of, people can see that I have a very rock and rollish side to me, and at my father's request, I play this one. It's just an instrumental, and it's a very common one. It'll kind of bring you down from the high. And then I'm going to jostle you back up, so watch out. That was called Walking in the Park. I forgot to announce the title. So I've already messed up. It's agreed we'd read some poetry here. I've got a couple poems here about the winter, you know. Both my father and I have increasingly seemed to hate the winter more and more as our lives go on. So, a couple of, though I do not know why. And so, I've got a little poem here called Winter Blues. Here we go. The cold winter day, it's kind of windy, like a Wisconsin winter. Got my stuff and I'm running like a world-class Olympic sprinter. Freezing in the wind. Slipping on the ice. Guess that's nature's way of waking me up once, twice, or thrice. Temperature's 25 below, and oh yes, the wind chill is 40 under. Wind whips past my chapped face, the sound of thunder. The winter, it's all iced up, and you can see your breath. It is kind of easy to get really cold, and you can freeze to death, by the way. So I stopped by a little park bench, and take a little breather and rest. When I sit down, chills reach the nerves in my ass. Man, winter can be a pest! Thank you. Okay, continuing on that suit, a poem. There's a poem here that I wrote in Spanish. Last winter, we all know how much snow we had. First time we had a triple-digit amount of snow. I'll read it in Spanish and then translate it on the spot in English. En unos meses hará buen tiempo. podremos ir a la playa. En unos meses estaremos haciendo las cosas de verano. Si yo tendría mucho dinero, compraría un coche caro. En los días de verano lo habré conducido mucho. Si no me quedará mucho dinero, será posible que fuere un poco pobre, pero eso no podrá prohibirme de disfrutarme. Entonces estoy esperando porque hay unos meses. En el verano, cuando tomaré el sol y nadaré, entonces yo seré ocupado. Sí, yo estaré divirtiéndome. And now I translate. Thanks. In a few months, good weather will be here. We'll be able to go to the beach. In a few months, we'll be doing summer things. If I were to have a lot of money, I would buy a very expensive car. And in summer days, I will have driven it very often. If not much money is left with me, it's possible that I might be poor, but that will not prohibit me from having fun. And so I'm waiting, because there are those months in the summer when I tan myself and I swim. So I will be occupied. Yes, I will be having fun. Thanks. You know, I keep forgetting to say the names. The name of that is Unos Meses, or En Unos Meses, which is literally in several months. Now, I bet most of us here play some kind of sport or something that involves skill that must be there. You know, I sometimes play sports, I suppose I should call them, and I find sometimes that a different me shows up when I'm playing. Sometimes the me that excels, and sometimes the me that just slumps over and dies, so it seems. And I wrote a poem about that me that I did not like very much, called Foo. It starts to happen at a time, and I feel all right. The pot starts boiling over in a hurry, and I begin to worry. It feels like execution by electric chair. And inconsistency kicks in. It's just not fair. I can't keep a limb still. I seem to lose my will. I'm momentarily in a stupor, acute absence of normal skill. Fingers start to shake, and I'll lose sight of what's at stake. Fool of the moment. You let the other side of you down. Fool of the minute. Where every villain your mind made the right sound. Fool, you should be locked away so you can't botch it up for everyone to see. Fool, you make it hard on me. I find myself in a self-engaged fight. I don't grant myself enough sleep at night. I think that contributes to my little twin foe that shows up every now and then, send me to a new low. So if you see me just standing when the fool inside me has struck again, and I stand and pop thinking one day I'll knock it out, this little fool! Continuing with the self-reflection, let's see here. If I can maybe move the mic over so this will suit. I take much pride in my being left-handed. And as we all know, the left-handedness, although mildly so, compared to other things, has been discriminated against, you know. When was the last time you saw a left-handed can opener? I had to go to Laugh Tracks to get one. so I wrote a song called Left-Handed Song, which is associated with the difference and being different, and how we are each unique, in my case at least. So I sing my left-handed song, 'cause I feel that way. I've said it all along, and as I play I start? Where did my journey begin? Got my virtues a bit more within. I can't hide uniqueness. I can't hide the contrast between me and all those typical, my first year, my last. I can put different clothes on, but I'll look the same. Anyway, so I won't try to alter myself, because it isn't such a shame. So I grew up with a few little things in my way. So unfatalistic, I plan not until today. And though we all seem the same mostly throughout, the word difference readily rounds this poem out. Demented page, as Letif put it earlier. Kudos, Lee. Ah! All right, the hardest part of this is going to be leaning over and trying to sing the words, but I'll do my best. It's called Daydream Shantytown. Thank you.
over to my father, who will read various French poems translated by his truly, by Jacques Brel, Jean-Roger Cotillon, and Léo Ferré.
If time permits. One is from Fred, who's the one perhaps best known in the United States because he was, some of his works were translated. And this one I'm just going to read to you. It's called The Statue. I had read it here before. I'd like to grab the son of Mary, who engraved under my statue. He lived all his life between honor and virtue. I who cheated my friends from false oath to false oath. I who cheated my friends from New Year's Day to New Year's Day. I who cheated my mistresses from sentiment to sentiment. I who cheated my mistresses from one springtime to the next. That child of Mary, I'd like to have him here, and I would like children not to look at me. I'd like to grab that child of Lent, who engraved under my statue, the gods recall those whom they love, and it was he whom they loved the most. I who never prayed to God, except when I had a toothache. I who never prayed to God, except when I was afraid of Satan. I who never prayed to Satan, except when I was in love. I who never prayed to Satan, except when I feared God. That child of Lent, I'd like to have him here, and I'd like the children not look at me. I'd like to grab the son of a bitch who engraved under my statue. He died like a hero. He died like they don't die anymore. I who went off to war because I was so bored. I who went off to war to see if German women. I who died in the war because German women. I who died in the war because I couldn't do otherwise. That son of a bitch, I'd like to have him here. And I would like that my children didn't look at me. From the late, and I think great, Jean-Roger Cousimon, actor, poet, singer, songwriter, I'd like to dedicate this one. I'd like to dedicate this one to my son Mitch, to Nick, and to Sam. Called Father Time. My daughter led me by the sleeve up to the bench under the line. They'll take a walk this Sunday eve. I'll stay behind. I'm Father Time. I was born, bah, so long ago. It wears me out to count each year, to count each spring or winter snow. I'm an old man, let that be clear. My pupils have become all gray. The time has passed when I could see. But I sense weather in my way. Before it rains, there's rust in me. Today I sense the weather's clear, and I can hear. My ears are good. The birds are flying through the air, and bees are buzzing in the wood. I have no fear that they will sting, that I should harm them, not a chance. They know I like to hear them sing. I hear girls going to the dance. In groups of five and six they go. The sunshine crowns them with its flame. And so it was long, long ago, except the girls are not the same. You never think when you are young that one fine day you've got to give. You think youth's song is always sung, or better yet, don't think, just live. You take a wife and kids come out. So proud you are, yet in despair to see these tiny toddlers sprout. And then one day out of thin air, you see your daughter's grown a bust, your son a soldier in his prime. You tell yourself you are robust, and so you think, until the time the road you followed when in the pink has led you to grief after grief. You see it all within a wink. How long this life and yet how brief. My daughter led me by the sleeve, up to the bench, under the line. They'll take a walk this Sunday eve. I'll stay behind. I'm father time. Another one from Jean-Roger Cousimon. Three terms. There are three terms I'll use no more. Once, formerly, in days of old. Three terms imposed on me before. Three terms as beautiful as gold, which take you back, alas, a score, and put on you the past's firm hold, like someone's story of the war, which for the umpteenth time is told. Once, formerly, in days of old, may my fingers burn on my pen, and may my heart be turned stone cold if I should use them once again. The present, rain or sunny sky, comes to us and already it's the past. How do you keep what flashes by? There's no one who can make it last, like sand in hand to make a pie, like water from a torrent's blast. All must crumble or come to dry between our fingers tightly clasped. How do you keep what flashes by? On films, on records, in your den, or with the short-term goods you buy and memorize time and again? I drive along the motorway with speeding motorbikes galore. All cities look alike today. Which one is which, you can't be sure. And sometimes you can't even say you recognize them anymore. And I roll on, cost what it may. Where are the flowers of the moor? American pop is on the air. All cities sound alike today. I listen, but don't really hear. It tranquilizes my dismay. Once, formerly, in days of old, these terms have dried up in my pen. And may my heart be turned stone cold if I should use them once again. Hey, Letif, this is for you. If you're still around, take it again. This is from the late, great Léo Ferré. It's called "You're Swingin', Baby." With our feet avenued in blood, with our hands nailed upon doors, and our eyes slits of slimy mud like the droppings of wasted whores. With lungs of nicotine and tar, with plaster stuck upon our faces, and women sent to yonder star with our pajama embraces. You're swinging, baby, you're swinging. With bastard morals full of cracks, with God a date upon our coins, millennia still in almanacs, still lodging in the Savior's loins. And then look at our mushy flesh of bony fat and meat so gory, which sails toward death each day afresh upon the mast of boss's glory. You're swinging, baby, you're swinging. With our ears pressed up against walls, with our glut of polyglot tongues, tape recording in plaintive calls the bloody scales of our songs. With our fur now nylon coated, ripped from weeping panthers' guts, and shop windows profit bloated, preparing fashions for old sluts. You're swinging, baby, you're swinging. With our journalistic hovels, where fester worms of all sizes, and corpse-like novels we shovel into literary prizes, and then our unopulent tippers beside our anonymous poor, and the rage next to their zippers, spawning nippers for the next war. You're swinging, baby, you're swinging. This being said in verse of 8, I bid farewell to human laws and eagerly await the date to crawl away upon all fours. Once again, Ferré, this was, he didn't belong to any group. It was this artistic spirit credo of this one called the Anarchists. They don't make 1% and yet they're still around. Most of them are from Spain. Go find out the reason why it is that in Spain they are out of season, the Anarchists. They know the ins and outs of paving stones and clouts. They shriek so hard before that they can shriek once more. With their heart in the lead and a dream as their creed, and their souls gnawed to tears by their screwy ideas. They don't make 1%, and yet they're still around. Sons of nobody great, or sons of the low paid, they pass you by unseen, except when you're afraid. The anarchists. They died time after time for no reason or rhyme. With clenched lovers they pound on the table or ground. With that obstinate will which can make the blood spill, they've struck so hard before that they can strike once more. They don't make 1%, and yet they're still around. And if you want to start a fight with hands or feet, just don't ever forget they swarm into the street. The anarchists. They have a flag that's black at half-mast on hope's back, and monotonous gloom woven in their life's loom, and knives with which to clip the bread of their friendship, and arms covered with rust, for remember, they must. They don't make 1%, and yet they're still around, and they're still holding up, arm in arm as they meet, with joy, and that is why you'll find them on their feet, the anarchists. Thank you. I'm going to do just one, I'm sure we must be running out of time. I just want to do one short one that I want to call Mitch back up to end on a happy note. I'm just going to do a short one by Fire here. The birds of woe.
Oh, sounds good.
They have long beaks. They have piercing eyes, just like women, the birds of woe. They have charm and flit about with cries, just like women, the birds of woe. They have paws and walk up in the skies, just like women, the birds of woe. They have their nests with all our children, just like women, the birds of woe. And it's with that we go to bed, and it's for that we wind up dead, as we try to teach them of doubt and distress. Come with your long beak. Come with your piercing eyes. Come with your charm, with your paws. Come with your nest. And with our child, my lovely bird, woe.
Yeah.
I want to just conclude this. Just a few things. Most of you probably know this already. 10-term congressman, rabidly anti-black, anti-Jewish, savagely anti-gay, anti-lesbian, also having punched out a fellow congressman in Congress, Bob Dornan, was finally defeated. I am not saying to you that the guilty get punished or that he is a fascist bastard. There are libel laws. He may not be. And we are having this seance tonight here in Montreal. That may be true too. Cynthia McKinnon, congresswoman, black from Georgia, gerrymandered out of her seat, won it anyway. Paul Wellstone in Minnesota, the only senator up for a re-election this year to vote against Clinton's welfare bill and to come out, take his case to the people, got re-elected. Every once in a while in this country, in an election, a good deed goes unpunished. And it's on that note, from another era, which had a lot of loose and sloppy thinking, and which I don't want to idealize, but which was the last time that this country ever tried to use its democracy. And taking its note, in this case, a rare example of country music backing up what was essentially a folk protest song. This is off Joan Baez's 1972 album from a Willie Nelson track, One Day at a Time. And it goes something like this. Thank you.
another hand for Larry and Mitch Lewis. And Francis DiMenno, the wrong here. We have about a dozen readers for our next round of open readers. We're going to be back in 5 minutes with that. So, good Lord's will it. Run around for five and come back and be in your seats, please.
Thank you.
Ready for our second open set here at TT the Bear's Place. Again, thanks to John for covering the camera for our TV show, the two-hour show, every Thursday night on Channel 19, Cambridge Cable, and every Monday evening, 11 o'clock, on Somerville Cable. Two-hour show there, too. And hello to the folks out there. We're going to start this set, again, reminding you, 4 minutes maximum, please, if you could. We're going to start with Jessie. Let's have a hand for Jessie.
Ladders like scaffolding for the poor and unknown. He watches me while I sand for $10 an hour, a stranger's facade down. And he asks me if I can imagine what he must be thinking while he watches me on the board, bouncing. Little, little, fat-faced, paint-shat-on, needle-dick whom employs me, I laugh at you, I resist you. And for the sake and righteousness of Dorothy Parker, might I add that when I fuck, the board bounces much harder. And this is a poem I wrote this morning. Yes, Virginia is flowing hard today. So this is very experimental. I haven't even read it more than twice, so I guess clap to let me know what you think of it, so I'll know. It's a fuck poem. And I've heard some really good fuck poems, and I don't know if this is qualified to be called good, but it's a fuck poem. Fuck David Letterman's well-timed punchlines. Fuck the mailman's handful of student loan bills. Fuck Sally Mae twice. Fuck dope, fuck smack, fuck alcohol, fuck pills. Fuck this poem, fuck this life, fuck these wars, fuck this survival chore. Fuck this fuck poem, fuck this baby drone. Fuck the time, fuck the rhyme, fuck the blood all over my thighs. Fuck the NEA and its charity grants. Fuck the DEA and its just say no chance. Fuck no, fuck yes, fuck why, fuck you, fuck me. Fuck the coffee, fuck the cigarettes, fuck happy, fuck angry. Fuck the morning, fuck the night, fuck all the fucks that come between. Fuck bumper stickers that say, have a nice day, and mean people suck. Fuck the waitress, fuck the hostess, fuck the cook. Fuck the rapist, fuck the sodomist, fuck the feminist, fuck the anarchist. Fuck the New Yorker, fuck the Wall Street Journal, fuck the Boston Globe, but don't fuck Dorothy Parker or Caligula. But fuck the little girl and her red wine and chocolate, fuck the dream, fuck the scream, fuck every burnt bridge, fuck all open doors, fuck platefuls of necessary starch, fuck the Civil Rights March, fuck God, fuck Buddha, fuck the Messiah, fuck the living, fuck the dead, fuck the needy, fuck the rich who give, food to the poor on Thanksgiving. Fuck the gas pumper. Fuck the taxi driver. Fuck the politician. No, don't fuck the politician. Forget I said that. But fuck the mathematician, the scientist, the dentist. Fuck the dietist. Fuck the gynecologist. Fuck the magician. Fuck America. Fuck France. Fuck icy blah blahs, underpants, fuck nuclear energy, fuck solar energy, fuck the North Pole, fuck the South Pole, fuck the meridians, fuck the welfare recipients, fuck Clinton, harder than Dole, don't fuck Perot, he's too little, fuck fire, fuck air, fuck water, fuck earth, fuck the dying, fuck the living, fuck the babies before their turn, fuck the biting of my lip every time I say fuck. Fuck the already done fuck poems, fuck love, fuck hope, fuck anything that says it gets better with time. Fuck your mother, but don't fuck mine. Fuck the Nazis, fuck the hippies, fuck the yuppies, fuck the wasps, fuck the yippies. Fuck Skipper and all of Gilligan's Isle. Fuck light, fuck truth, fuck ignorance, fuck denial. Fuck bad circulation, fuck good hair days. Fuck toll booths, fuck voting booths, fuck kissing booths, what's a booth? Fuck. Fuck the stars, fuck the moon, fuck the sun, popping in and out and in and out. Fuck the wind, fuck the rain, fuck the hail. Fuck good fucks, fuck bad fucks, fuck what the fucks, fuck ugly ducks. Fuck the sleeping beauties, fuck first kisses at the movies. Fuck going Dutch, fuck being butch, fuck fairy tales, fuck bedtime prayers. Fuck mythology, fuck James Joyce, fuck Shakespeare twice. Fuck oceans, rivers, lakes, water, fuck oxygen, fuck calcium, fuck vegetarians, fuck carnivores, fuck the mad cow, fuck the whiskey bar, fuck the low-tar cigarettes, fuck the doors, fuck Beals, fuck self-addressed stamped envelopes, fuck we only take unsolicited poems, fuck your agent, fuck your pager, fuck your cellular phone, fuck your four-door cars, fuck your two-car garage, fuck the delivery, fuck the stanza, fuck your lying eyes, fuck your static thighs, fuck your annual physical, fuck your good Samaritans, fuck the virgins, the bastards, the whores, fuck this pen, fuck this audience, fuck this poetry thing, fuck idealism, pessimism, realism, narcissism, fuck feminism, racism, heterosexism, ageism, anti-Semitism, other isms, fuck money, fuck time, fuck your mother, but don't fuck mine.
That was Jessie. I'm reminded back in the 20s, in the expatriate group in Paris, a young man brought a group of pages, his early writing, to a woman who was quite renowned for her taste. He went back a week later. The man was Ernest Hemingway. And we went to Gertrude Stein's place, and she handed him back his material, and she said, "Well, you've said fuck. Now what have you got to say?" And he went on to, of course, say other things, which remarkably. But at any rate, we now have Carol Weston. Yay! We don't have Carol Weston at this time. We're not going to have any. So we'll have Elizabeth Thomas to be followed by Carol when she gets ready. Okay? So Elizabeth, I hope it's Thomas. God bless.
Not like I'm ready either. Well, I'm going to connect all of that together and read somebody who was an expatriate poet in Paris in the 20s, and I'm going to read a poem with the word fuck in it. So there's cohesion for you. I don't care what you want first, you're getting the fuck poem first. While you're out, crashing through the screen door, I ripped out poppies with no trace of guilt. Pacing the sweltering yard, I ravaged peaches and crude consumption. Then, falling on the cracked ground, I crossed my legs so tight it crushed, and with the sun glared at my breasts. I wish you would. I would have fucked you till the sweat would detoxify us, till the salt would dissolve us. So that's the fuck. Now that I got that out of my system. This is HD, the expatriate poet in the 20s. And this is from Sigil, it's part 11 and part 14, I think. If you take the moon in your hands and turn it round, maybe a slightly tarnished platter, you're there. If you pull dry seaweed from the sand and turn it round, and wonder at the underside's bright amber. Your eyes look out as they did here. You don't remember when my soul turned round, perceiving the other side of everything. Mullein leaf, dogwood leaf, mothwing, and dandelion seed under the ground. This is, hey, fuck you. This is